We've got a crime theme on the programme this evening. Our main guest at 11:20 is going to be Kate Cray, who is the former wife of Ronnie Cray, and she's also now written a book about hard men. And she's also bringing with her somebody called Big Bad John. As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a TV presenter. To me, being a presenter was better than being an assistant manager in Shoe Express. Even before I first wandered into the Generation Game audience, I knew I wanted to be part of the BBC. To me, it meant being a Jeremy Paxman in a neighborhood that was full of Tanya Briars.
And though my pocket may be empty, I'd be a millionaire. My clothes may still be torn and tattered, but in my heart I'd be a king. Your love is all that ever matters.
Thank you. This is your recommended daily allowance on BBC Choice. Today is Monday, the 10th of July. It's the day that troops move in at Dumcree, and Britney Spears announces that she'd like to be queen. But more importantly, 50 years ago today was the day that saw the start of the Battle of Britain, and this was quickly followed 22 years later by the birth of popular TV presenter Gabby Roslin. And we thought it would be appropriate to celebrate both of those remarkable dates in one. Gabby Roslin was born in London in 1964. After graduating from the Guildford School of Acting, Gabby worked in children's television before landing a prestigious job on Channel 4's The Big Breakfast. After the fall of France in June 1940, Hitler turned his attention to a demoralized Britain, deploying his Luftwaffe, which had gained valuable experience during the Spanish Civil War. In 1996, primetime beckoned, and Gabby left The Big Breakfast to host The Gabby Roslin Show. She further consolidated her reputation. Oh, now the clip's just stopped. So that was all the clip that we had. We had too much script and not enough clip. So how long have I been sitting here reading this out like a ninny? Not long. Well, thank you for the support, Floor. All right, so anyway, so Gabby and you get the idea. All right, listen, I've got a confession to make. It's to you, the audience, to my friends and colleagues who work here on the show. It's quite hard to admit this, so I'm just going to have to tell you straight out. I'm afraid whilst we were off the air, I went on another show behind your back. I'm sorry, I know it's hard for you to understand. But on Friday, I was a guest on an entertainment programme, which is also on BBC Choice, called Liquid News. And believe me, if it's any consolation, you know, if you think I make a pig's ear of this show, you really should have seen me on that one. I was excruciating to watch. I think we've got some tape of it, actually.
I have no opinion.
We've got a problem with your microphone.
Oh, is there?
So could you not talk?
Wait, is it working?
John, we've got your mic back up.
Yeah, well, it's no surprise that I would come on and the technology would completely screw up. I have to say. Yes, and I think this really is in the spirit of my show, and I'm sorry to have brought the jinx of my programme onto yours.
Do you know what? I accept and embrace what you've brought.
Would you really?
Yes, I do.
Well, shall we hug?
No. John, music festivals, let's do this whole thing again, yay or nay?
I know nothing about music festivals. I really feel we should hug.
We can't hug at the moment because I have more news to do.
Fine.
We'll hug at the end, I promise.
Could we?
John, your choice in one word.
My choice? I think I shall rent Cop and a Half.
On that, I've got to go.
Third weekend
this has been Liquid News. Thank you very much for watching. See you next week. Bye.
On the line now is Christopher Price from Liquid News. Christopher, hello.
Yes.
I'm really sorry that I wasn't very good on your programme, but you managed to sort of hold it together. You know, I thought you were pretty funny, at least.
Well, what do you mean by funny?
Well, that you're just that you're funny. I thought you were a funny guy.
You mean the way I talk? Funny?
No, just funny in the way that you tell stories. That's what
funny,
I mean.
Funny how? What is funny about it?
No, you know, Christopher, I didn't mean to piss you off. You've got it all
funny
wrong.
Funny how?
Well, you're just funny. That's what you are.
Right, let me understand this. Funny kind of messed up in the head. I'm funny like a clown? Is that what you mean? Amuse you? Don't make you laugh? Funny? How?
No, Christopher, you're just a funny... All right, Christopher, thanks. Can we stop that?
Funny.
All right, thanks. Now we present an item that we hope will become a regular feature of the show. It's called What Would Paul Koya Do? Israel's ultra-Orthodox Shaz party has left Ehud Barak's governing coalition in the run-up to tomorrow's Palestinian-Israeli summit. The question is, should the Shaz party have left Barak's government or remained with the governing coalition? Well, tonight we ask, what would Paul Koya do?
Well, if it was up to me, I would stick with Ehud Barak's governing coalition. It's a difficult time, but there's too much at stake, so stick with it.
Now, we've got some tape apparently coming up. Now, often we just see stuff, it just shows up, and we just like it, and we can't think of funny things, but we just like the fact that there's a woman on a catwalk somewhere wearing that dress, and look at it, she seems to have somehow solved the problem of how you can go indoors and stay outside at the same time, I'm not sure, or go outdoors and stay inside, or... I'll tell you what, why don't you record this show on lovely tape and edit together the correct grammar for yourselves? I've been having an email correspondence with a certain newscaster on News 24 lately. His name is Matthew Amrillawalla, and I don't know if you're aware of his work. He is a great newscaster, but there is something about him, I'm not sure exactly what it is. There's a whole look. There's something about him. I cannot stop looking at the man, and I'm not alone on the staff here. And what we've done is compile for you a month of news in the life of Matthew Amrillawalla. See if you can get into him the way I did.
It's British stores.
And the shame South African cricket captain Hansie Cronje has admitted taking money from bookmakers. Good afternoon. This is BBC News 24 with Jane Hill and Matthew Amrillawalla. Well, the Foreign Secretary, Robin Cook, has just been talking to journalists at the Foreign Office about Sierra Leone. Two of Britain's best-known companies have announced disappointing annual results. Police are searching for a man who hijacked a passenger jet in the Philippines. Got weather coming up for you in a moment. The government of Sierra Leone has ordered all children fighting in its army to return to the capital, Freetown. Now, the Welsh Assembly has set itself on a potential collision course. The Islamic separatist group holding 21 people captive. United Nations peacekeepers have come under fire. Now, within the last few minutes, the new mayor of London, Ken Livingstone, has agreed to set up. Hello, this is BBC News 24 with Rebecca Jones and Matthew Amrillawalla. Ford has confirmed that it's to end car production. The Home Secretary, Jack Straw, condemned the mindless violence. A gynaecologist accused of incompetence or job losses have been announced today. The government of Sierra Leone. Fans start to arrive in Charleroi, Britain's defence secretary. The musicians involved, more than 1,000 British troops. The lethal cocktail of Don Prescott, Johnny Diamond. Let's get the rest of the day's business news. Got weather coming up today. The time has just gone 4:30. Let's have a summary of today's top stories.
I'll be honest with you, there is something about him to me. He is compelling, the mouth, the jaw. Did you get into it? Did it have any effect on any of you here tonight? Not for any of you. Well, what a surprise that would be, eh? I don't know. To me, the man's extraordinary. To me, the hair especially. The world changes, but the hair somehow remains the same. I can't work it out. But one of the great things about working in this institution for the next month or so is that there is this thing here called the internal email where you can directly access newscasters and presenters and various people without having to find out their email addresses because they're all on the internal mail. So what I did is at the end of last week I actually sent this fella an email and it says, Dear Mr. Amrillawalla, this probably sounds stupid but I'm a new presenter on BBC Choice and my hair looks terrible. I was wondering, where do you get your hair cut and how do you maintain it? Please answer back, this is not a joke, John. And he actually then emailed me back, John, I'm definitely not the man to ask on this one because it is the constant battle of my life. I've tried everything, including going to Nikki Clark, that TV hairdresser, at a cost I won't embarrass myself by telling you. But now I just go downstairs to that TVC place. There's actually a barber here in the basement of Television Centre. There's a whole kind of internal community that operates here with its own system of government and politics and everything. It's an extraordinary thing. But anyway, he goes now to just the bog-standard BBC barbers. But he says, I'm still not convinced. Both my mother and my wife keep saying it looks like a wig. I think it's very telling that he would put those in that order as well. Do you not think? Mother and wife.
But no disrespect to the man, because he's genuinely good at what he does. There's no question of us kind of having a pop at him. But the sad thing is that they're not teasing me, they mean it. Good luck, if you find the answer, let me know. So it was a very charming and very gracious reply to a sort of semi-serious email. So I'm going to send him one now on the show. Dear Matthew, thank you for your speedy and good-humoured reply. Tonight, I'm afraid... Oh, my goodness. Tonight, I'm afraid I'm emailing you during the recording of the programme I'm presenting. If you're getting your hair cut in the next 3 weeks, is there any chance I could join you? And that way, we could have our hair cut together on my show. Thanks, John. And let's send... Go. Fly, little one, be free. Yeah, we've done it. OK, cool, so we've done that. These, by the way, are exactly the kind of conversations that occur between BBC on-air personalities. There's legendary correspondence between Esther Ranson and Anne Robinson about how to dispose of a horse carcass. That's a fantastic, fantastic piece of work. Hello. This is your recommended daily allowance. Today is Monday, the 10th of July. It's BBC Choice. If you would like to contact us, why not give us a call? Our phone number is 0208 225 8898, or you can email us here at rda@bbc.co.uk. Now, if we could all just take a moment, I'm sure that you've heard of the tragic news. Poet Percy Shelley died 188 years ago today. We've had many requests to mark this sad event with a piece of his work, so here goes. When the Lamp is Shattered, by Percy Shelley. When the lamp is shattered, the light in the dust lies dead. When the cloud is scattered, the rainbow's glory is shed. When the lute is broken, sweet tones are remembered not. When the lips have spoken, love accents are soon forgot. As music and splendor survive, not the lamp and the lute, the heart's echoes render no song when the spirit is mute. No song, but sad dirges like the wind through a ruined cell, or the mournful surges that ring the dead seaman's knell. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. On Wednesday night, anyone watching the show, ever? Wednesday? Oh, last Wednesday was interesting. We had some French people in the audience. It was the night that the Generation Game audience spilled into our studio. And we had them, and we had some French people there as well. One of them was learning English. There was a woman from Basingstoke called Liz, and there was a French guy called Fabian. And I ended up talking to them throughout, during the show. And I think we've got some stuff on tape of what happened.
Have you been to Basingstoke? You connaissez Basingstoke?
Never.
It's beautiful. It's the jewel of the Near West. It's lovely. You should go. Well, yeah. How could we send Fabien? Maybe, Fabien, could we send you to Basingstoke perhaps tonight, and you can make a little film for us and
yeah,
come back?
Right. No problem.
Would you two mind kind of hooking up after the show?
Yeah.
Not in the hooking up American teenage sense, of course. I mean, would you be willing to do that, and we could maybe see what happened, you know, tomorrow night on the programme? Would that be a good thing to do?
That's
would that be okay? But only you, yeah. Only you, Fabien. These deadbeats, no way. Just you. Would that be okay?
So there you go. It's very odd. It kind of looks like the Jerry Springer Show, doesn't it? It has some of that. I stole my sister's husband about it. All right, so basically they ran off, and the next day they recorded some tape for us. So let's have a look at Liz and Fabian's Basingstoke adventure.
All right.
Hi, Liz.
How
are
good.
You?
Fine?
Yeah.
Welcome to Basingstoke.
Yeah. Very nice place. A nice station.
Love
I like that. It.
Can actually see the rebuilding that's going on now.
Fabia, this is the new shopping centre that's being built. This used to be all car park, multi-story car park. And they've knocked the majority of them down, and this is the new building.
When the construction will be finished?
I think 2 years.
In 2 years?
Yeah.
Okay.